Good morning from not so sunny Yorkshire today. It's August, it's absolutely freezing. I can't deal with it. I'm just not cut out for this. Today I wanted to talk a bit about university reasonable adjustments for students who are starting this year and have a chronic illness or some kind of long-term health condition. If you're completely new to this world, I think we should start by talking about what a reasonable adjustment actually is. And essentially, colleges and universities have a legal duty to provide any reasonable adjustments that might reduce the barriers that somebody with a disability or a long-term illness might face in their education and accessing their education. Generally speaking, to access reasonable adjustments, you have to be somebody who identifies with the definition of disability that's provided in the 2010 Equality Act. And I have that here, so don't you worry. Okay, so the definition of disability is that you must have a physical or mental impairment that has a substantial and long-term effect on your ability to do normal daily activities. It's important to say as well here that in this particular video, I'm not going to focus so much on the application process for things like DSA, which stands for Disabled Students Allowance, because that in itself is a separate thing to what I see as requesting reasonable adjustments once you've secured your university place, you know where you're going, and you're starting to put things in place ahead of your studies. I go into that process in a lot more depth in my book, which is called University and Chronic Illness, A Survival Guide. It will be linked below and it's available on my website. We go much more into that process in there. So you're off to university, you've gone to your disability services, you've sat down with the disability advisor and they have said to you, what can we do to offer reasonable adjustments and make sure that you can make the most of your education? So the first adjustment I wanted to talk about is lenience with attendance. Because when you have a chronic illness, it simply isn't possible to always leave the house and always make the contact hours that you need to. In the case of non-disabled students, most universities have a medical absence policy, and that means that if a student misses a significant amount of time, they have to self-certify their illness, they have to provide medical evidence, and it's a whole shebang. It's a lot of admin. And that's fine for a non-disabled student who, for being ill, might be a bit of an anomaly. But when you're dealing with a chronic illness, the chances are these instances are going to come up more and more, and you can't be faffing around with admin every time that happens. It's just unrealistic. Because of that, one of the things that I personally requested on my support plan was lenience with absences. And that would basically mean that in any contact hours I had, there would be an understanding, I suppose, that I might not always be able to make the hours physically, but that I will be doing the work from home. When you're asking for this adjustment, it's important to know that you don't have to disclose any medical information that you're not comfortable sharing. But for me personally, I found it helpful to explain that because I have an energy limiting chronic illness, it's not just physically being in the lecture that I have to allocate energy for. Even just getting ready, commuting to the lecture, the physical and sensory exertion of just being around other people and being in that environment, all of these things take a lot of energy expenditure from me, and as a result of that, attending one lecture could make me very poorly for sometimes several days at a time. Explaining that to my disability advisor lent itself quite well to asking for this adjustment, this lenience with attendance, because I explained that by being able to work from home, I could avoid some of that energy expenditure and I could work more smart. I could work smarter. I'm making this video about university and I cannot brain today. If you're requesting lenience with it, oh, big plane. If you're requesting lenience with attendance, it's really important that you get this in writing as part of your support plan that your disability advisor will put together. Because what will happen when you've both signed off on that support plan is that that will be sent on to any lecturers or course leaders or tutorial leaders that you have in that academic year. So like I said earlier, they will already have that understanding that although you might not physically be there, you will be doing the work in a way that's accessible for you. The second reasonable adjustment I wanted to talk about is one that absolutely blows people's minds, because every former chronically ill student I've talked to about this has had no idea that this was a thing they could even ask for, and it is hands down the adjustment that helped me the most throughout my studies. That adjustment is taxis or transport to and from contact hours. Similarly to the other adjustment, this one made a big difference for me in terms of energy expenditure and pacing myself, because by having a taxi provider to and from the contact hours that I was able to attend, I didn't have to factor in the energy of what was initially a 20-minute walk from my student house to my university, or when I became too ill to do that walk, I was having to get two buses like away from the area I was going to come back in again because I couldn't walk the distance. So having the taxis available did reduce a lot of the, not only the exertion, but just the faff of having to deal with that more often than not. Strictly speaking, this adjustment would fall under DSA rather than reasonable adjustments through your university. Although, if you are unfamiliar with this adjustment, speaking to your disability advisor could be the way to go about facilitating this, especially because it still seems so unheard of and people don't know that it's out there. If the system is still the same as it was for me back in 2015 or 2016, if you're having subsidised taxis, there will be two different ways of going about this. First of all, you could initially pay for the taxis out of pocket and get a receipt, and at the end of each term you would send these receipts off to DSA and they would reimburse you. Or you can set up a standing order or some sort of arrangement with a local taxi company so that they will provide the journeys and the payments will be taken care of automatically by Student Finance. It goes without saying that the latter option there would be the least faffy and the most energy efficient, but I personally had issues in getting that set up, so in the end I just resorted to the first way of doing things, so paying out of pocket and getting them reimbursed. If you're doing this, it's absolutely essential that you get receipts and that you get receipts that are signed. I actually faced some issues because some of the signatures weren't clear enough on my receipts, so they didn't get funded, but we won't even go into that now. It was a lot of admin doing things this way, but ultimately it was something that was beneficial for me, and I do feel that could be beneficial for other students with chronic illnesses as well. I had some very strange conversations with taxi drivers over those years. Number three is a fairly straightforward and self-explanatory one, and that is requesting deadlines for assessments and extra time for exams. That said, I do think some students with chronic illnesses again feel as though they're not able to ask for these things, and I think that's very telling of the way that the education system has made people with chronic illnesses feel. But like I said earlier, please know that you are entitled to these adjustments. Again, if you're working with chronic illness, it can take you longer to complete routine tasks and to conduct your studies. Every little bit of the academic system has to be broken down and paced when you're dealing with something like, for example, ME, fibromyalgia, conditions of that nature. But I mention it here because requesting these things as part of your support plan is a different process to requesting, what's it called? It's different to requesting exceptional circumstances. So while on the one hand, if you were in exam season and you found yourself particularly unwell, you could go down the route of extenuating circumstances. What you want to be requesting in your support plan is a routine process for requesting deadline extensions, and the bonus of doing that is that you will know in advance exactly how to go about doing that, so when the time comes you can request these things as early in advance as you need to. Not as you need to, you should request them as early. Let's try that again. If you're in a deadline season and you feel as though you're going to need the extra time, make sure you request that as early as possible. If you're not sure whether you're going to need it, my personal advice would be to request it anyway, because at least then it's done. You can always hand it in earlier if you end up finishing earlier, but at least you'll know the extra time is there. The fourth reasonable adjustment I wanted to talk about was requesting accessible rooms and venues at your university. Access at different universities can vary quite dramatically. Even universities who claim they are accessible can have all kinds of inaccessible shenanigans going on. And the reason I wanted to mention this one is that even if you personally don't use a mobility aid like a wheelchair or a walking stick or a crutch or anything like that, you have a right to request that your contact hours are held in locations that are more accessible for you. A straightforward example of this would be requesting that your contact hours are on the ground floor so that you don't have to deal with stairs. But one that might be slightly more out there is requesting that your contact hours are in a slightly quieter location, one that's less central on campus, to reduce some of the sensory overload that you might experience. And the same goes for exams, actually. That's on a slight tangent, but you can also request that when you have to sit exams, you can request to either be in a smaller room with fewer people in it or in a room all by yourself. I talked about this in the book, but I personally went for the smaller room with other people in it because the idea of being by myself actually made me a bit more nervous, and I thought there might be more energy expenditure required to, I don't know, like communicate with the invigilator when I needed to. I don't know if anyone else can relate to that. It's important to say for that one that these requests sadly can't always be accommodated by universities, and I really don't envy the person who has to try and facilitate where different contact hours are going to be for like thousands of students. That can't be an easy job. But like I always say, there is absolutely no harm in asking. And the final adjustment I wanted to talk about today is one-to-one support. And again, I think people with chronic illnesses assume that they aren't as eligible to ask for these things. And this is actually one where I look back and I think maybe if I had had the guts to request that, it would have been something that really helped me. Students might already have a PA or a carer who supports them in day-to-day life. That might be an arrangement that's already set up and something that naturally transitions to university. But even if you don't have these things in place already, that doesn't mean that you can't request additional support during your student years. Even if you personally don't require medical or personal care, the way we traditionally think about support work and care work, there are other things out there that you might find beneficial. I mention this because one reasonable adjustment that you request might be a non-medical helper. And these helpers can do all manner of things. And again, I think it's a case of really sitting down and thinking about what you might personally benefit from. A non-medical helper might help you to pack and carry your bags to university to reduce some of the exertion. If you use a transit wheelchair, they might push the wheelchair for you. And just assist with day-to-day tasks that somebody might ordinarily do for themselves, but they might need a little bit of support with. My phone just completely shut off then, and I thought I'd lost the 19 minutes that I just recorded and I was gonna have to start again. Oh, I'm not cut out for this on a Tuesday morning. Let's try that again. Another example of a non-medical helper might be a note taker. So again, self-explanatory. This is somebody who comes along to your contact hours for you and they will write down what needs to be written down so that you can focus. You're not trying to multitask. If you're like me, you might find that handwriting takes quite a bit of exertion and can be a bit painful sometimes. And it's worth noting that note takers are trained to be note takers, so you can trust that the quality of their notes is going to be good. I'm thinking of others now. Another one that you might be interested in is a library assistant. So if you have a library on campus, you'll know that these can be very big buildings, very tiring to walk around, and a library assistant can help you to source the reading materials that you need. If you are interested in a non-medical helper, it's worth noting that different universities facilitate this in different ways. And again, I know this one can be a little bit complex because there is an overlap with DSA. If you're in doubt, you can talk to your disability advisor, but I would advise getting that in place as early as possible, and it might be that DSA are the people to go to. If there's something that you are a little bit worried about and you think, oh gosh, I don't know how I'm going to manage that, that is the kind of thing where a non-medical helper might come in. If going to university and becoming a student is the first time that you're going to be moving away from home and living independently, again, it's worth thinking about the aspects of that that you might find difficult, because that can be quite a big transition and quite a big adjustment. So again, if you're in doubt, I would be inclined to advise asking for more than you think you're going to need. Because the worst that can happen is that they say no. And I think it is important to say here that with DSA and reasonable adjustments alike, it's not always possible to have them all accommodated. DSA and university budgets for reasonable adjustments, I suppose, if anything, they're getting smaller. DSA's definitely faced a lot of cuts, and I think I might have been in the last year before DSA significantly reduced. So again, my best advice is to ask for as much as you can. It might not all be granted, but at least you'll have asked and you'll be in with a chance. And there we go. So like I said, that's definitely not an exhaustive list of reasonable adjustments. Definitely not. And there are more in my book. It might also be worth looking into reasonable adjustments online, whether that's through university websites or student bloggers, other information you can find online. Definitely worth looking into what's helped other people, but also really worth it. It's just sitting and just writing down anything that you feel worried about, anything at all that might be helpful to you, no matter how rogue or how random that might seem. It's worth remembering as well that university disability advisors are there to help, and if you don't ask, you don't get. So I know it can feel a little bit scary and a little bit daunting to have these conversations, especially because people with chronic illnesses have often been made to feel as though their needs are a burden of some kind. But at the end of the day, reasonable adjustments exist to put you on a more level playing field with non-disabled students. So I think it's really important to ask for what you need so that you can make the most of your university experience. Get the ball rolling as early as you can, because that means by the time term rolls around, all of the things are lined up and ready in place so that you can just really concentrate on settling in and just having a jolly good time. I don't know why I think I'm from the 50s. Having a jolly good time. You know what I mean, having the best experience you can. You can also find out more about DSA, making a support plan, communicating with lecturers and your disability advisor. All of that stuff is in my book, University and Chronic Illness, a Survival Guide. It's the book I wrote because I so badly needed it during my own student years, and it doesn't just focus on the academic side of university, but just the overall student experience as well. So things like going out, socialising, living independently, managing your money. Just, I really wanted to make it a comprehensive resource, and I'm really glad it's helping people. So like I said, that will be linked down below. Oh, I really hope that's been somewhat helpful at least. And if you're a student preparing to go to university with a chronic illness, I really hope you have the best time possible. I know it can feel scary and overwhelming at times, but it can be such a brilliant experience. I'm a bit jealous if I'm being honest. Anyway, thank you so much for watching. You can subscribe if you want, and I will see you next time.